Good morning, Seattle Christian Church. Welcome. We're so excited to see you. Will everybody please stand as we enter into praise and worship this morning? Woo!
Oh, Says he knows your needs, but it said to pursue him, seek him, seek his kingdom first and his righteousness, and it said all your needs are going to be met. Can I tell you something? The box that you put God in, would you kind of kick down the walls of that box? Can you kind of remove the ceiling? We have in our heart what is called an acceptable manifestation. Well, what does that mean? We look around to everything in our life and we predetermine how God can move. Can God do something different in your life? And would you yield to him? Not your way, his way. The Bible says in Proverbs 14 and 12, it says, there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to destruction. It seems right. It looks right. My friend said it's right. But it's his way. It's his way. I want you to have an expectation for the Holy Spirit to move in your life. But I need you to allow him to do maybe a manifestation in your life that's unacceptable. Amen. Can he do something in your life that he hasn't done before? What does that mean? That means you got to let some things go. Remember, release always comes before your increase. That means you got to forgive some people. You got to get rid of the issue. Well, how do I know that they've been forgiven? Well, I'm not thinking about them and their name isn't coming out of my mouth anymore. That means I've released them from things. You got to release some people. You got to let it go. And you got to let the Holy Spirit start moving. You got to let it go. You got to let it go. Soul ties got to be broken. You got to let it go. Let it go. And let today be your clean slate. Just say, Lord, today, I'm going to forgive them, I'm going to release them, but today, start it afresh in my life. Start it afresh today, amen? Can the Holy Spirit heal some people this morning? Hey, guys, I need you to work with me today. You know why? Because we just had a breakthrough class on words of knowledge, and I got some I got some students that are taking risks here for the first time. And I don't need disobedience in the house. What does that mean? If they call out to you, you just say, hey, that's me. That doesn't mean, hey, that's me. That means, hey, that's me. That means your hand goes above your head. Guys, this is a house of signs, wonders, and workings of miracles. So I hope you came to the right place this morning. Because the Holy Spirit loves to show up and show out. Amen? I will never assume to have more mercy than him to see people healed, to see them delivered, to see them prosper. Amen? So we had a class, and we prayed together, and the students, Christian, if you come up, the students in the class said, well, I believe the Holy Spirit wants to heal certain issues. Amen? So if we call out your issue, just keep your focus on the Holy Spirit. And remember, in Luke 1 and 37, it said nothing's impossible with God. And what he's saying, there's no active voice from God that will come into your life without his ability and in the instruction to do the very thing that he said he was going to do. Oh, look at Tom sneaking up here. I was like, man, words are coming out of nowhere. But here's what I want, church. We get excited. When we get through class, keep it going. Keep it going. What are you talking about? I keep telling them. I go to Costco. I get words of knowledge. I go to other places. I go to workplaces. I get words of knowledge. Why? Because my heart's affection is anchored on him. Not wrapped up in the work, the paychecks, or anything else. It's him. It's his kingdom. It's what he wants to do. Amen?
Okay, so we got a lot of great words from our students today. You're going to hear a lot of duplicates, but just raise your hand, and then you can come up at the end after we call them all out. So we have right sciatic pain.
If you have a right sciatic pain, go ahead and put your hand in the air. Any issue on the right side? I called it out last week. I think it was an appropriate Christian word called a butt cheek. So if you got that, or if you got pain just on the right side of your spine, go ahead and put your hand in there. Work with me. And if I'm not seeing it, somebody else point to them. Amen? Is that her? Okay, there we go. I didn't see your hand. You got to kind of elbow and then stick your... He's too close to you. Amen. So who... Shawnee, just remember, if you're the one that gave me the word, remember who's putting their hand in there, okay?
Okay. I've got like 30 more words to go, so hopefully Greg doesn't interrupt after each word. No. Okay. Rapid heartbeat, anxiety, a digestive gut issue.
Amen.
That's Deanna. Is that you? Was it you? Okay. Who gave that word? That's you? Okay. Well, you're an old timer.
We got left ankle. Anyone with left ankle? And a right hip. That could also be the right sciatica. I have redness and extreme itching, burning in the palms.
Where's Brody at? Brody's the ankle. Where's he at? Oh, there, you're hiding? Okay. Jehovah Sneaky will get you.
We've got pain from a decayed tooth on the left side of the mouth. Right ribs. Back pain associated with kidney on the right side.
Who's that? Any one of those issues? Go ahead and... Any one of the issues? Okay. Whoever gave me that word, just look around. Oh, is that you? Are you the... Okay. Who gave that word? Mona, where are you at? You got Kevin here with the mouth, and you got... Okay, I'm just trying to... Are Mona, you got it? All right. Well, you guys just raise your hand. We'll have people pray for you.
Okay. So, Linnea got throat pain. Pain on the right side of the neck. Okay, perfect. And then left shoulder pain.
Who's the left shoulder? Okay. Oh, that's Linnea, right here. You got her, you got Tracy, you're going to be busy.
Okay, we have left clavicle shoulder pain again. and then stomach pain.
Is that anybody? Those are they're duplicates, I know. Okay. Right here. Oh, is you? Stomach or okay. Whose work was that? Okay. Was that yours? Okay.
We have anxiety. And right side of head, there's pain and trauma. Anyone with trauma to the head? And so we got stomach and rolling sensation in the stomach. So got a few stomachs that were going. Left hip pain down the left leg. Anyone who's having left hip?
Left hip pain going down your leg.
And then pain in the right calf. And then we have a left ring finger, kind of a burning sensation under the ring. Anyone feeling that? And then tingles in the scalp and seeing new hair sprouting, and I know who that one's for. And then we got right big toe is pain and swelling. One for toe. Okay. And then we got left hip again. And then we've got burden of life weighing you down. So basically oppression.
Okay, guys, if any of your issue is called out, just go ahead and put your hand in there. Just put your hand in there. And those of you guys, some people have more than one word of knowledge. Just, you know, just pick. Robert, why don't you lay hands on Tracy? If you could pray for her. Guys, keep your hands in there. We want to make sure we get everybody. There's people that are sitting down right there. Crystal, you're gonna take all three. I got someone here with Kevin. You got Laleen, you got Brody. You got your daughter. Okay. Still got Kevin here. I need someone praying for him.
Somebody get Kevin.
Brody, yeah. Does everybody have somebody praying for them? Is there anybody that doesn't have somebody? Right here. Okay. Jeff, right there. There you go. Anybody else? Everybody got somebody right here? Right there behind you? Sure. Right there. Okay. Guys, don't be afraid. It's not about you. The word's already been released. I just need you to come in agreement and help them. Amen? You guys will be like, so let's go ahead and pray. Short prayer. The word's already been released. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we declare your will. Your will is that every single child within the hearing of my voice is healed this morning in the name of Jesus. So Holy Spirit, come upon them. And Lord, I thank you that the word that we send will prosper in the air that we send it to. So I command your people to be free. I command it to be healed right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now watch this. Go ahead and move it. Go ahead and move it. Do something you couldn't do before. Some of you take a second or third time. Do something you could not do before. We saw 15 people healed last Sunday. Let's go ahead and move it right now in the name of Jesus. Now, some of you, if you feel like you have more relief than you've had, go ahead and just wave your hand at me because I want to. So right there, we got more relief. We got two right there. Anybody else? Anybody else? So let's go ahead and pray again. Now, all we're doing is we're showing you what the Holy Spirit is doing now. I'm not saying there's 100%, but I'm showing you the Holy Spirit is moving. Now, let's go ahead and pray again. So if there's something that's stubborn, if there's something that's, if something moves, if any pain moves, that's affliction, the person praying for him, you got to command that thing to leave. We'll cover that next week in breakthrough. So right now, go ahead and pray for him one more time. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, in the name of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus, I come against every spirit of infirmity. I come against pain, torment, Lord God, and I come against any difficulty that the enemy would try and come upon them, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus, Holy Spirit, give them more. Give them more right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, I detach everything that the enemy tried to plan for them, Lord. I command it to come off and off them right now in Jesus' name. And I command the children of God to be free now in the name of Jesus. Don't think about it. Move it. Look for your healing, not your pain. Look for your healing right now in Jesus' name. Take your stand against the enemy and just move it. Mock the enemy and move it. In Jesus' name, you will not be bound any longer. I break the spirit of fear right now in the name of Jesus. God hasn't given you fear. He's given you power. He's given you love, and he's given you soundness of mind. In Jesus' name, be free. Be free in Jesus' name. Now, if you have 80% relief or better in the place that you once had pain, go ahead and wave at me. There's one healing there. There's two healing there. If you go ahead over your shoulder, let me see it. If you have relief in the place, there's three healings. Anybody? Anybody else? Anybody else? I got him up top. Anybody else? In Jesus' name. Guys, go ahead and put your hands together for Jesus. Greet your neighbor this morning. High five them. Tell them they're healed in Jesus' name.
Welcome to Seattle Christian Church. My name is Josh. This is my wife, Deanna. Nice to see everybody. Are there any new faces here today for the first time? If so, please raise your hands. His wife's here first. So we'll get you a welcome card and a little gift for you a little bit later on. So Deanna and I have been coming here for almost 5 years now. Actually, at the end of the month, it will be 5 years. She was going to church out in Redmond, and I had to steal her. She didn't realize I was signing her up for First Steps, and she came in and met Greg and was overcome by his confidence. a quick announcement. We're actually doing a date night for couples at the end of the month on the 27th, and sign up is on the church app. But we're gonna do some artwork, and you know, most everybody knows. What was that? Okay. So last year, everybody here pretty much knows Tyrone, right? Kind of intimidating looking guy that acts like he's smiling at you when you come in. Well, he, you know, is not known for being Picasso, but he actually had the best artwork last year. So everybody can like put out an awesome painting. I think what Greg did last year is hanging up in their bathroom, you know? Oh, it was Kristen, sorry. But yeah, it's a dirty poor style, so you don't have to have any artistic ability to make something really cool. So hopefully you guys can all make out make out afterwards, not here at church. But we're just gonna charge $50 and then hope that everybody can bring a dish. So it'll be an awesome date night. And did you have anything else? Okay, cool. Well, Josh, you can roll the announcements, please.
Welcome to Seattle Christian Church,
where our motto is we are doing life better together.
And here are some ways you can do life with us. Join us for noon prayer on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. Starting in May, we're going to have our marriage Mondays again. Sign up on the app. On Tuesday nights at 7 p.m., we have our men's group.
Midweek service starts Wednesday at 7 p.m. And the first Wednesday of every month is potluck. Then we also have youth every Wednesday at 7 p.m. as well. Then we have Celebrate Recovery every Thursday at 6 p.m. Starting soon, it will be the step studies. So see the app or the website for details. Also coming up, we have the art worship card making on April 20th at noon. So if you have some artistic ability, or if you don't, and you just like making cards, come on through. We also have the couples paint, pour, and potluck, April 27th at 5 p.m. So again, bring food and also bring your significant other, because it's gonna be a great time.
We are so excited for our third annual women's conference on May 17th and 18th, so please sign up on the app.
So right here is a QR code. It's for you guys to get connected, register for events, you know, just become a part of this family.
Let us all stand. How is everybody? Today is my day to have the opportunity to ask for an offering. One of the things that I like about this opportunity is we all get a chance to give. Hope my voice is not that bad for some reason. But you know, I think it's real important to know that when we're able to give, a lot of us, we give money, but I think it's real important that we can give our time, our understanding, and most of all, our thanks to God. Oh, today is one of the days for me that I'm a little bit emotional, a little bit excited, just being thankful that once upon a time I didn't have any money that I could give. But one of the things God has done now, he has blessed me to where I do have a few pennies. But you know, it's so good that if you can just give of yourself, give of your knowledge and just help somebody. So today, whatever you have to offer, it's not just your finances, it's just being able to be thankful for having a blessing. So go ahead and take out your checkbook, your cash, or whatever, and be thankful. Lord, we thank you for this that we are receiving today. Bless the gifts, the givers. And we give it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Give. Give.
Good morning, church. How's everybody doing? How you guys doing in the balcony? My name is Tyrone, and I've been tasked with the privilege to lead us in communion this morning. I want to open up with a passage of scripture first, out of 1 Corinthians 11:23 to 26. For I have received of the Lord, which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner, also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come." With the body and blood of Jesus Christ, God created and established a supernatural and eternal covenant to transcend that which is of the old. Because a yearly sacrifice of blood, bulls, and goats was not good enough, nor was pleasing to the Father, because it did not have the ability to cleanse the sin conscience, nor the residue of sin, which is the shame and guilt of it. Jesus Christ came to rectify the law. He said, "I will put my laws in the hearts and minds, and their sins I will remember no more." Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God, the perfect and ultimate sacrifice. And from it, the Father was pleased, because it took care of your past, present, and future sins, and your past, present, and future healing, physical, mental, and emotional. To be set free, healed, and delivered is your inheritance as a kingdom citizen. When he took the bread and he broke it, he said, "As much as you partake in this, do it in remembrance of me." Say this out of your mouth. Jesus remembers my sin no more. So I will remember my sin no more. Go ahead and partake. When he took the cup and he supped, he said, "This is the New Testament covenant, which is in my blood." Go ahead and partake. Put your hands together for senior pastor Darren Calvin.
Praise God. That's a good looking Bible you got there. You put $100 in there too. I like that. Praise God. How many of you guys like when people can prosper around you? Amen. It's my prayer that every one of you prosper. God bless you, Brother Giovanni. Is that your dear wife right there? God bless you. So wonderful that you've been lending your wonderful husband to this body. He's been such a blessing to the men and to Celebrate Recovery. And we're just blessed to have you with us today. So God bless you today up from Portland. Can you guys give yourselves just a great big hand today? I'm just kind of looking around the building. I'm so blessed. My daughter is in town, and she had a film festival downtown, and so I want to thank y'all for letting me be a father first, amen, and then I came in, and capable men standing up to declare the works of the Lord. Can you give Brother Lane and Brother Tyrone a great big hand? Glory to God. I know Brother Greg is ready to unleash on us, and he's about to unleash to you, but let me drop this word in your heart today. If you can, help me on the screen for just a moment. Go to 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, and I'm going to have you look at the 9th verse for me real quick. You notice that my creative ability didn't go out so strong. From about March to April, I got an epiphany. I was like, this is going to be the month of receiving God's grace. And then April came around, and I heard the first voice of the Lord. He said, this is going to be the month of receiving God's grace. And I said, God, are you aware that that's what it was last month? He says, yes, I am. And I said, well, God, what are you doing? He says, well, they didn't receive everything that I needed them to receive. So we're just going to take another month to receive God's grace. And if you'll just take these next 2 or 3 minutes, let's receive that grace fresh and new. Amen. I believe that grace is empowering. I believe that it's undeserved. And I want you to read about a man by the name of Paul here, and one of the greatest men that ever kind of came across the kingdom of God, in that he wrote, you know, maybe 2/3 or 3/4 of the Bible. He was a good man, confident man. And all of a sudden, he says these words, and I want you to put yourself in his shoes. He says, for I am the least of all the apostles. You guys able to find that one for me today? I'm looking in 1 Corinthians 15:9 in the New Living Translation. Brother Josh, God bless you. Let me take a moment. Hello up there in the balcony. God bless y'all. God bless you. Did you guys go around and give everybody a hug today? I missed that, so y'all gonna have to come up and eat some chicken with me after service, and make sure y'all come and give me a hug, or I won't be able to make it for the rest of the week. Amen. All right, there it is. There it is. Look what it says. He says, I am the least of all the apostles. In fact, I'm not even worthy to be called an apostle after the way I persecuted God's church. And so regardless of what your background was, that did not disqualify Paul from being used by God and the grace increasing upon his life. So no matter where you came from or what your background is, God's not holding that against you. Can you wave your hand to the Lord and say, thank you, God? So whatever it is, whatever it was in your past, you have the opportunity to turn it around. You have an opportunity for God to bring something on your life that can be a blessing to someone else. And I want y'all to say these words. Say, for whatever I am now, come on, say it like you mean it today. Say, for whatever I am now, it is all because God poured out his special favor on me, and not without results. Say it one more time. Say, and not without results. I believe today that special favor is coming upon us, and not without results. I told y'all that if anything, I'm going to downplay what God's been doing in my life. God bless you, brother. It's so good to see you back there, man. I haven't seen you in years. God bless you, man. You know, I'm going to downplay it. I don't want to be big hat, no cattle. Mm-mm. I don't want to be a talker and not a liver. I got to be all about that action, boss, right? And I want you to understand and recognize that if grace is not something you can put on your life and take to your job and take to your neighborhood, then there's something wrong with the favor of God on your life. Paul said it in another translation, by the grace of God, I labored harder and more stronger than all of you, right? For I have worked harder than any of the other apostles, yet it was not I, but it was God who was working through me by his grace. Amen. Lift your hands all over the place. There's a strange thing about grace. You're not going to go and earn it. You're not about to go and pray and take 15 different hours to get it. No, you're going to get it right now. And if God's got to extend it another month, he'll extend it another month. But I'm telling you right now, this is your moment. This is your time. It's done by a supernatural move of God. Jesus has made it available to you. And right now, the Holy Spirit is an administrator of the grace and favor of God being poured out on you right now all over this church. So right now, I release the favor, the special favor of God for every occupation, every endeavor, all of the people going to school in Jesus' name. I release a favor and a grace upon you for learning. Your ability to accelerate and retain
and recall information, knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. I release that grace upon your life right now in Jesus' name. May God make you wiser than your teachers. May God put upon you a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. May He increase your ability to see and discern and perceive knowledge that He's trying to get to you. May you be able to understand the voice of God and everything you read. May you be able to retain it and recall it and teach it and live by it and put it into action. If you can receive that right now, say, I receive in Jesus' name. By the grace of God, do that for us, God. We receive that right now. Now, see, I just sense a wonderful just presence of God just come in just now to release that on some of the people's lives. I received this grace way back in 1994. I was a good D student. I mean a good D student. And all of a sudden, this grace came on my life so strong. That it took me all the way through law school, all the way through a master's in taxation, all the way to being able to study the Word of God more than I was studying scholastically. And retention and retaining my accelerated ability to see information, hear knowledge, and take it. God increased that on my life. Somebody say, God, me too, right now. I receive that right now. In Jesus' name, take it in. Take that in and receive that for just a moment. Just have that. That's yours. Just have that. That's yours. Just begin to rejoice in it. Just thank God for it for just a moment. I'm a quicker learner. I'm a faster learner. I'm a more complete understanding person. I'm much more stronger in knowledge and understanding. Practical application is my heritage. I receive it right now. I'm able to take information and implement it in my lives and into the lives of others. I receive that right now. Whatever class, whatever course of study, whatever book the Spirit of God has led you to read, now you increase in your understanding and wisdom of it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, especially upon our teenagers, God, upon our children, God. They go from D students to A students in Jesus' name. Father, upon our ministers in the fivefold ministry, God, wisdom and revelation comes upon them in increased fashion now in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you for our business owners that need to know things that books can't teach. I declare that their perception of what other people have done comes upon them and makes them ready for positions that you put them into that their resumes say they weren't qualified for in Jesus' name. May there be a street. Watch it now. May there be a practical common sense and a street knowledge come upon you right now in Jesus' name. May you be able to look at a person and the knowledge and discernment of the Holy Ghost come upon you and know whether or not you should do business, you should do relationship, you should partner up with them. I release that grace upon you right now. It's a grace. It's a grace. It's a favor. And I release that upon your life right now in Jesus' name. And Father, I just give you thanks. I just give you all the praise for that right now in Jesus' name. Father, I call forth promotion through this grace now in Jesus' name. Father, may there be promotion that does not come from a job, that comes upon your people right now. Father, does not come just from creating a business or a structure or an organization, but let there be a promotion that can only come from God now, that will cause them to be heralded amongst men and women, Lord God. You said you'd make their name famous and distinguished, and they would be blessed and be a blessing to others. And so let promotion that cannot come from man come upon us now. I receive it in Jesus' name. If you can receive that, just begin to give God some grace, some praise and some glory today. Just receive your promotion. Receive your promotion like you believe you got it right now. If you believe you got it, receive it like you know you got it right now in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Father, I release the anointing of a multimillionaire upon this place right now in Jesus' name. Father, what they could not build themselves and by themselves, I declare a grace comes upon them to build empires, to build organizations, to build investment portfolios, to build real estate portfolios, oh God. God, in Jesus' name, right place at the right time with the right people that puts upon them an anointing for a multimillionaire right now in Jesus' name. Not just millions, God, but multiplied millions of grace right now released upon them. this congregation. And Father, I declare and decree that it is not too much for many in this room, that it is designed and declared for them to carry what you call them to carry. And so, Father, without deserving, without desiring, without meriting, Father, right now, an empowerment and an understanding, an ability, a gifting and a skill, a diligence, a consistency, and an implementation grace comes upon us now in Jesus' name. And I decree and declare that a multiple anointing of grace and favor comes upon you for millions. And you shall not have 1 million or 2 million, but you'll have multiplied millions in your life. If you can believe you receive that right now, just receive that in Jesus' name. Just receive it. Just receive it. God is a faithful God, and He'll do it in our lives every single time. So we just give God all of the glory and all the honor and all the praise. I receive and I release right now the grace that we released a couple of weeks ago for overcoming mourning, grief, loss, and hurt. We shall not go into our future with the sun going dark and dim, but we go forth in our future with a bright optimism, with a light that shines inwardly and pours out of our lives. We see things positively. We see things optimistically. We walk by faith and not by what we feel. And so by your glory, the best days are ahead of us. We don't think about the past. We look forward to the future. We thank you for all of that bright shining, all of that bright glory, all of that bright joy. And if you can believe you receive that right now, just believe you receive it right now in Jesus' name. We are done in the position of crying. We are now in the position of rejoicing and joy and peace. And that is our strength, and that is our heritage. So we receive it now. Give God a great big hand praise. Give God a great big shout. Glory! Hallelujah! Glory to God. I want to take this time to acknowledge our kids. I think they're still in the room. Yes, they are. I see a couple of them. I just want these people that are next to them. Can you stretch your hands onto our kids right now? Just if they're next to you, just put your hand on them right now and just bless them. We bless you to be the head and not the tail. We bless you to be above only and never again beneath. We bless you to be history makers and world changers. We bless you to have a strong mind. We bless you that all fear be off your life. We bless you to receive the love of an almighty God. We bless you to walk in a relationship with Jesus Christ all the days of your life. We bless you to hear the voice of God. We bless you right now to be obedient to the instructions of the Lord. We bless you right now to have favor and open doors that no man can shut. Bless you for open doors of opportunity upon your life in Jesus' name. Say amen. All right, all of the children are dismissed, so go ahead and let them make their way on down. Well, I drove up to the campus and people are outside taking a smoke break. I didn't even know that the people at Seattle Christian Church took smoke breaks. And I call forth the anointing to make you want to puke every time you smoke in Jesus' name. I just release the early anointing in this place. Every time you smell a cigarette, may you just physically get sick to your stomach. Mwah! Straight from Pastor. Yeah, that's one way to get over it, huh? Somebody say, I receive. That's right. You think I'll play it, but wait till you have another cigarette. It's going to be horrible after that. You're going to be like, Lord Jesus. What did Pastor release in that place today? Well, I met a man in a coffee shop about 17 years ago. And he was a man of like kind. It was surprising to me. I don't meet a lot of men like myself that can walk in business and also walk in the priest anointing. And when I met him, I was looking for somebody who could stand boldly and preach the gospel, and I didn't have to see a drop off every time I got ready to leave. I was never going to leave if I couldn't find somebody who could carry the anointing of being able to love the people and drop a word on their lives.
And so all of a sudden in this coffee shop, I was looking at him and I was staring at him and I was like, my God, where did he come from? And I knew God had hid him away for years and he didn't even know the fullness of what he was going to be walking in. And now we've had the privilege of seeing him start to walk in what God always had on his life. How many of you know you don't have to have a heritage of granddaddy and great-granddaddy being preachers? You didn't have to go to seminary. No, God just pulls people out, puts his hand on their life, and all of a sudden, next thing you know, they're ready to go off and do the work of the Lord. Amen? He is one of the greatest gifts that God has ever given Lynn Felice, and I, he and his wife have served faithfully here in this church, and I just want you guys to stand up and give a great big honor, give a great big applause and praise today to our associate pastor, Pastor Greg Barrett.
Thank you, Pastor. You guys, you could be seated. And I met with Pastor because I was ticked off at the church. And I'll be real with you, my body was in church, but my heart wasn't. And there was a lot of frustration, especially when you deal with people. When you come to church, you got to remember, you're dealing with, it's a hospital for the broken. Right? And so the church had beat me up. And I told Pastor, I said, I was done, but the reason Pastor and I had,
Oh, man. I didn't want to interrupt.
You should have thrown your mic at me.
I'll be quick, I promise. Can't interrupt the man of God.
Falling in love with Jesus. There's no place I'd rather be. Lord, there's no place I'd rather be.
She's standing there all quiet in the background. I tell everybody, hey, throw something at me if I'm not seeing you. Amen. So Pastor and I met in a coffee shop. God gives me a word because he just stepped in. And I don't know why I was never introduced to Pastor. So Pastor and I really never had a conversation. And when we started the conversation, the Lord spoke to me as an usher saying, you're the associate pastor. And you guys got to know me. I'm not looking to preach. I'm not looking to do anything. I'm like, cool, then tell him. Right? Because when a new pastor comes in, everybody's like, I'm a deacon. And I'm not that guy. I'm going to stand in back and it's either God, it's you. Or I'll just stay ushering. So he goes, hey, why don't you go home for 5 days and we'll meet in 5 days and you meet back with me and we'll see what God says. Why already? I'm like, well, God already spoke to me. So he comes back laughing at me. He goes, God says you're my associate pastor, but I thought you'd be a black guy. I'm a brother inside. Amen. Amen. I'm like... But can I say something? So I'd seen, you know, some pretty cool miracles and things like that, but I almost felt like the church beat me up because of it, because it seemed like there was this competition. I'm just like, then you don't know me, because I just want to see people get well, right? That's all I think about. So I came to pastor kind of beat up, and he didn't know me, didn't know anything about me. He walked right up to me. He said, your gift doesn't intimidate me. And he goes, in fact, I'm going to use your life. And I'm like, so here's what I'm saying. Just so you guys know, if you haven't been to any other churches, they're not going to let you preach. They're not going to let you lay hands on people. You're not prophesying. You're not doing any of this stuff. Now, there's order in the house. But Pastor Darren trusts you, and he trusts God. But he also recognizes the gift that's on your life. And guess what? He's a smart man. Why? Because he's going to invest in you. Because when you grow the kingdom, he gets credit for it, and the church gets credit for it. So go out, make $1 billion. We're still going to take credit for you, and we're going to be like Seattle Christian Church. It's like we train that dude, right? Go out and kill it, because all we're going to do is take your credit. Aaron, when you do the platinum album and everything else, we're like, yeah, we raised her. I'll be like, I taught her how to sing. You don't want me singing. All right, guys. Go ahead and stand for the word. They were like, if you taught her, it's a miracle. I'm going to go to Isaiah 45 and 3. And Isaiah 45 and 3 says, I'm going to give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches and secret places, that you may know that I, the Lord, who call you by name, am the God of Israel. Hidden riches and secret places. Father, in the name of Jesus, show them. Show them that you hide things for them and not from them. So, Father, today I'm going to release a word in their life, and a word, Lord God, that you are going to increase them today. And the church said, amen. Guys, go ahead and take your seats. I'm gonna go through this pretty quick. I told Pastor, I told my wife, the Lord spoke to me this week. I walk up. She's in the bathroom getting ready. I said, guess what, honey? She goes, what? I said, I'm preaching this Sunday. And she goes, pastor's preaching. I said, no. I said, this word's too good. I said, I'm preaching this Sunday. She goes, pastor's preaching. I said, you don't understand. There's an anointing on this word. We went back and forth with the pastor. Pastor goes, hey, you're preaching this Sunday. And what's that about? It's recognizing what God deposits in your life and what to do with it. Oh, so you mean... you recognize when something came in your life, it wasn't for you. It was for the people around you. Oh, yeah. You better recognize what God's putting in your life and the territory, the area that he wants you to sow it in. I'm going to drop some kingdom principles today, and I'm going to talk about wealth. I hope I don't offend some people. A lot of you know I teach on words of knowledge, signs, wonders, and workings of miracles. But you also don't know, some of you do know, I also run 3 businesses outside of this church. And every business I've ran was prophesied. The last business that put me into a 7-figure income in its first year was prophesied by Pastor. Oh, you mean there's some value in being coached? Yeah. So I laid out my agenda. I come here to the church, and I run 3 businesses. We have the God standard after breakthrough, just to throw this out there. The God standard is going to start. I'm going to teach on kingdom wealth, and I'm going to offend some more religious people. But, you know, it's good. So I'm going to teach on money, because without money, you can't minister. The poor can't help the poor. So I'm going to teach biblical principles to wealth that God's given pastor. I know he's given me. And so you could see how we build these companies. How do I run three companies at once in a ministry? Right? It could be done. Some people sleep too much. Some people aren't leveraged enough. But it could be done. And God will open the doors. Now watch this. Just like healing, all we're doing in healing is we're creating an atmosphere where you can receive a manifestation from the Spirit of God. So we're actually, words create atmosphere. So we're creating an atmosphere. So when I start talking about wealth, I'm creating an atmosphere so you can hear the Holy Spirit and how He wants to bless you. He wants to prosper you. He wants to establish your boundaries so He can get things working in your life. Right? So I was sitting there, and this message was written in a place of pain. I looked up on my board and all the red letters a couple weeks ago. I'm like, wow, I'm owed $94,000. These suckers, I got done working on their house and they don't pay. And I got the insurance to pay them, but they won't pay me. So here's what God speaks to me. He said, you have two ways to respond. You can respond in urgency, because here's my first thought. I'm shutting all the business down. We're not going to work. We're not going to work until everybody pays me what they owe me, because I'm ticked off. And God said, well, you can go ahead and shut your business down. He goes, or you can think about the possibility and keep dreaming. Well, if you look up the word possible in the Bible, it always goes to dunamis. It talks about power. And it's not your power. It's connecting to the Lord's power. So God says, well, I need you to hire another crew. And I said, no, I'm not hiring another crew. And him and I were going back and forth. I'm like, I'm collecting. I'm going to be a debt collector. I sent out some nasty texts. I'm like, you don't pay. I'm going to refer that account over to an attorney to start debt collection practices against you. And you owe me. We did the work. I paid for everything. And nobody likes to be in the red. So God said, you have two ways to respond in life. You respond to every situation based on urgency or your possibility. And your urgency is your order. And your urgency is in fear. And I'm going to tell you this. There is no creative ability working in your life when you think urgency. And let me give you another word for urgency. It's called obligation. When you wake up and all you think about is your debt and your problems and all your thing, and I just need another dollar to pay, there's no creative insight or ability working with you with that mindset. You have to start thinking about possibility. Well, how do I think about possibility? I think about His ability, His promises, and what's my role in this covenant relationship. So I'm going to go to the parable of the talents. I'm going to go through it real quick because I need to get to the book of Ruth, because God spoke to me in all of this. He goes, I've insured. He said, I have an insurance plan for your wealth. He said, people have wronged you. He came to me in a place of pain. He said, I'm going to show you an insurance plan that I have to prove to you that I'm working on your wealth. And guess what? He said, you're preaching it this Sunday. Why? Because it wasn't just about me. It was about you. God is trying to get something in your life. Just like when we do words and odds, try and get healed, and you guys come up there with your foot like this, I ain't falling down, all these games we play with the Holy Spirit. God's like, no, I'm going to get it to him. I said, okay, cool. So let's go to the parable of the talents, and I'm going to go to Matthew, let's see, Matthew 25, March 17, 1997. I was in the church 6-8 months, started tithing. It took me 6 to 8 months to get it through my head that God wanted to bless me. I didn't jump right in. I got a revelation. And then after that revelation, I said, God, I said, I want to work for myself. I want to be a business owner. And quicker than I thought, March 17th, 1997, the Lord visits me at work. And he said, where I'm calling you, he said, your job cannot afford to pay you. I said, what did you say? He goes, oh. He said, you're in Israel right now. Or no, he said, you're in Egypt. I said, what's wrong with Egypt? He said, there's three things that Egypt stands for. He goes, it's a place of refuge. It's safe. It's good to visit temporarily. He goes, it's a place of refuge. He goes, it's a place of limitation, but it's also a place you flee from. Interesting. So he said, it's safe. Now watch this. This is a question I asked my son earlier this week. You were raised and born in sin in a prison cell, and it's been locked. Now here's what you have. You have an Egypt. You have your food taken care of. You have your clothes taken care of. And you have your housing is taken care of. That's taken care of. That is a guarantee. But when you walk in that prison cell, your creativity and your potential, you got to leave on the outside. You can't exercise that because you're in a place of oppression, because you're actually owned. Okay, so all of a sudden you get saved. Jesus opens the prison door and he said, you can stay in your known bondage. You can go back out to your unknown freedom. There's no guarantee. So what do you do? I asked this to Eli. I said, what do you do? He goes, so I got all the guarantees of safety and security. I said, yeah, so your obligations are met. He goes, but I got to go out to the unknown. I said, yeah, unknown freedom. I said, what do you do? Do you get up and walk out? Or do you stay where you're at? That's what he said. That's a very good question. He goes, geez, Dad. And I said, the Lord came and showed me he has an insurance plan for you so you can walk out of your jail cell. But you have an obligation in the covenant. And you can't stay there on your own. Yeah, you could stay in the job. But here's the thing. The reason God said what he said to me is because he needed an Abraham to walk away from his family and the family's economy. He needed a Moses to walk away from Egypt in Egypt's economy. He needed a Joseph to walk away from the family and actually influence Egypt's economy. You can't save somebody from an economy that you're involved in. Pastor's in a different economy. I know I'm in a different economy, and I don't know everybody's situation. But God put me in a place to be recession-proof so I could rescue people from a system and pull them out. I had this conversation with my brother last week, and he's, you know, got a safe job in union. I said, but your mouth is owned. He goes, what are you talking about? He goes, I'm a Christian. I'm not. I said, your mouth is owned. I said, are you speaking pronouns? He goes, yeah. I said, your mouth is owned. I said, and if you don't do it, I said, you're fired, aren't you? He goes, yeah. I said, your mouth is owned. God needs a mouthpiece in this world that's not influenced by anything but the Spirit of God. He wants life and truth coming out of your mouth. Now, some of you may get ticked off, say, I'm in a job. Well, you may have been called there because, like I said, Egypt is a place of refuge, but it's not your ending. Right? It's a place of training. You know what God wants you to do? He wants you to train in that place. He wants to raise you up so you could start your own thing. To be disconnected from a different economy to rescue people from that economy. Oh. Man, you guys can get real quiet today. All right. Matthew 25, verse 14. The kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country. He called his own servants and delivered his goods to him. And once, and to one he gave 5 talents. Now, 1 talent actually represents like 1.25 million, but I'm going to give you 1 million. Okay, so one he gave $5 million to another, and he gave according to their ability. Now, ability is dunamis, and it's the power to achieve by applying the Lord's ability. Your ability, and the same thing in Deuteronomy 8:18, it's the Lord that gives you the ability or power to produce wealth. It's being able to tap into God's ability. So God poured into them based on what? The exceedingly abundantly, above you ask or think, according to what? That's working in you? According to power, dunamis. So God gave them according to their ability, and he gave them excess according to their ability. Whose ability is the people of the parable of the talents? It's the Lord's ability. So they were working a system that he had already taught them. Now, here's the stumbling block to most people. It's this word called understanding. Read it. Matthew 13. So there is an understanding. No understanding on the path. Limited understanding on the rocks. Limited understanding with the seed that got choked out. And then you have understanding at different levels, 30, 60, and 100-fold. So understanding is the thing that's getting in the way. So we have the person with 5 talents that was given according to their ability. We have the person with 2 talents that was given according to their ability. Then we got this other guy that has 1 talent. God still gave him $1 million. That's not bad, right? Now watch this. Let's go back to the word I gave you. When you're given that $1 million, I'll give you an example I gave to Eli. I said, Eli, you got $5,000 in debt. He goes, yeah. I said, I just gave you $1,000. I said, what are you going to do? He says, I'm going to pay off my debt. Okay, so where's the creativity in that? First thing he thought was obligation. I was going down 105.3, listening to Spirit Radio, and they do those crazy sounds, and they call in, and they win. After 100,000 people finally call in and get the sound out of the process of elimination, what do they say? You just won $800. What do they say? I'm going to go pay off my debt. Where's the creative insight in that? There is none. It's called obligation thinking. Where's the creativity? It doesn't exist. It only exists in possibility. What's the possibility? It's His power working in and through you. Oh. Did I touch a nerve there? All right. So, then we got this guy with one talent. So the person with five produced five, the person with two produced two, and the person with one, it says, then he came to the one, in verse 24, with one talent, came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man. Knowing comes from experience. So he had a bad experience working in his life. It's the same knowing in John 8 and 32. It says, you'll know the truth. So there's a knowing by experience. So I've had some bad experience. I've had some issues that I haven't gotten over because people robbed from me. They stole from me. Every time I go out, it's the wrong thing because there's a way that seems right. But that end led to death. So I didn't get a word from you, but I connected myself to a bad experience. As soon as you gave me this money, all I thought about was obligation and urgency. And so, God, you gave me this money. And he said in verse 25, and I was afraid, and I went out and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have. I'm going to give it right back to you. I didn't even pay off my debt with it. Didn't even put it in the bank to gain interest. Didn't do anything with it. Why? Because I was afraid. Oh, you become like the one you worship. He had a bad perspective of God. He told God, he said, you're reaping where you haven't sown. He goes, that's how I see you. Now, what I see is I see a person who doesn't worship God. He's not a worshiper of God. He is a Christian, though. He knows some words, but they're theory because there's no experience. The only experience he has is bad experience, but he never came into a renewal to become like God, right? So he has a bad experience. So you have two guys that are doing well. You got one guy. God is giving an opportunity to the one that even though they have obligation, he's still going into him. He's still sowing into him. But the question is, what does he want you to do? Do business with it. Even when he gives you that seed, he wants you to sow because he wants you to think possibility and not urgency. Oh, okay. So let's go over to the book of Ruth. I'm going to come back to this one, but I'm going to do it quick. My wife says you talk too fast. All right, let's go to Ruth. I'm going to go to verse 1. Now, I'm going to give you a little backdrop. So Ruth is in a dilemma. Here's what I like to read in the Bible. In the Bible, it talks about there's certain seasons. I always like to see what God does in a time of famine. And then I compare this time that we're in, and people talk about recession and all this other stuff, and things are not happening. But there's this thing called a recession, and we're in the book of Ruth, verse 1. It says, now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. So there's a place of hardship. Now watch this. Here's what I think about. Maybe you think like me. Maybe you don't. When a market is doing well, everybody's like, the Lord's blessing me. Joseph got a word. 7 years of prosperity, 7 years of famine. 7 years of prosperity, everybody's knocking out of the park. The Lord's blessing me. It's all my life. And I'm sitting there like 2022 real estate market where, you don't even have to. You just put a lock on the door and it's sold multiple offers, 100,000 over. And they're like, the Lord's blessing me, and I'm sitting there waiting. I'm like, wait till this market turns. We'll see who's blessed and who's not. Let's see what happens when the famine hits. You'll be able to see the blessing from those aren't. You'll see that God moves more in the blessing than he does in the time of prosperity, but you also see the goodness of God. The Bible says the rain falls on the just and the unjust. He gives everybody an opportunity. Now, what are you going to do in a time of famine? Are you going to wait till the wheels fall off the bus before you change things in your life and get out of that prison cell? All right, we'll see. So, we got Ruth, and we got some characters here. We got Ruth, and we got Naomi. So, Naomi loses her husband. He dies, okay? And then we have her two sons. Orpah is one of the wives of the son, and Ruth is the other daughter-in-law. So, you got Naomi as a mother-in-law, so her husband dies. After her husband dies, then her two sons die. Once her two sons die, she has two daughter-in-laws left. One is Orpah, and the other one is Ruth. And what does she tell them? She says, go back to the land that you came from because you're the weakest. You have no provision. You're in a disadvantaged, place right now. And you need to go back to your mother's, and I'm going to tell you why, but you need to go back to your family. Go back where you came from. And Ruth is kind of like, dude, I'm kind of jacked up. And she goes, my family's kind of jacked up. And I would rather hang with you. And Orpah grabbed hold of her. Now, Orpah means she's a stiff-necked woman. So she's a hard woman. And Ruth is a person that you befriend. It actually says it's a person that you break up in order to make up. I got that from Tomi Ariyomi. But she's the person that you break up with an Orpah and you connect to a Ruth, and she's worthy of an investment. So God is saying that there's places that he wants to take you financially, because he can't take you because of who you connected yourself to. He wants to get a blessing in your life, but it's the person that you're connected to that he doesn't want to bless. So there had to be a breakup in order for the purpose of God to be fulfilled. Had to get Orpah, boom, stiff neck. It says that 33 times in the Bible. Any time Israel didn't do what God called him to do, he called him stiff neck. He called him an Orpah. So Naomi had to get an Orpah out of her life. Then she had to deal with a Ruth. Now Ruth was a person that she had to befriend, because Ruth said, listen, where you go, I'm going to go. And here's what she says in Ruth 1, in verse 16. It says, but Ruth said, entreat me not to leave you or turn my back on you, following after you. For wherever you go, she says, I'll go. And wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die. And then there I will be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts you and me. So she's saying, we're partnering together. So Naomi's like, I'm not going to fight you. You're going to come to me. We're going to go over to Bethlehem. So they go to Bethlehem. Why is Naomi going back to her family? Because there's a possibility of her being remarried because of a law, and I'm going to get to that. So Naomi said, hey, if you want to be successful, you got to do what I tell you to do. I'm going to lead you. I'm going to guide you. The Bible says in Matthew 5:5, it says the meek shall inherit the earth. And the meek is talking about your ability to be teachable. And it's acknowledging that you're powerful. But it's saying your power has to be restrained and submitted to the Lord in order for you to inherit the earth. So there is a principle as far as being teachable. The Bible says if you receive a prophet or a righteous person, you're going to receive the reward. It's what's called an inheritance. That's Matthew 10:40-41. But it also says in Galatians 4:1-2, God says, I'm going to put a coach in your life, and there's a time set for the Father for your maturity. And at the time of maturity, God says, I'm going to release resources into your life. So you have to go through this process of training. And Ruth said, hey, you're better than I am. I'm going to submit myself to you because I got nothing else. So I'm going to hang with you. I want to be grafted into your family. Sounds like your salvation. So I'm going to be grafted into your family. So when they get to Bethlehem, they said there was a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth of the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. So there was a Boaz in Bethlehem. And she says, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to connect to a Bethlehem. And once she met him, she told Ruth, I need you to go glean from his field. Go to his field. And go glean from him. And she goes, okay, cool. Well, actually, it was Ruth's idea, and then Naomi said, go. So she goes and she gleans. And then it says that Boaz saw her faithfulness. And it says in verse 8, once he saw the faithfulness of a Ruth, then Boaz, who is a relative, Boaz is a relative of a Ruth and Naomi. Well, he's a sister-in-law, but there is a closer brother than a Boaz, and that's key. Then Boaz said to Ruth, listen, my daughter, he said, don't glean in another field. Don't go from here, but stay close by my young women. Now watch this. He said, I want you to focus. He goes, let your eyes be on the field which they reap and go after them. So he is saying, I'm trying to get you into a place of prosperity. I'm trying to get you into a place of abundance. He said, let your eyes focus on the field. Well, here's what he said. Don't focus on another man. Don't focus on your need. Focus on the exact place that I told you to focus on. Why? Because it's that place that your provision is going to come from. So Ruth went to work in the field. And then after that, he said, it's been reported to me all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother and your land and your birth, and how you've come to a people who you didn't know. You've paid a price. The Lord will pay your work and fully reward by giving you the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for a refuge. Chapter 3. So in chapter 3, Ruth starts getting close to a Boaz. But Boaz is an honorable man. Now, I looked, and I didn't see anywhere that Boaz had a wife, and I didn't see where he had another child. So God had a need. And here's God's whole need. I need the bloodline to continue. I need the inheritance to continue. You can't take your inheritance when you go. So God is determined that there is no child coming out of Boaz right now. But it says he's surrounded with women. But Boaz is a righteous man. He's an honorable man. He only wants what God wants for him. He had wealth. He had everything else. But he didn't have a wife. He didn't have a child. Watch this. And Naomi did not have a son because her two sons died. So Naomi needed help. And then you have a Ruth. She didn't have a son. And they're all crying out to God. And God says, I have a plan. I need the inheritance to exist. So I got to bring two people together, and I got to establish something in this family to honor the bloodline of the deceased so their inheritance can pass through into future generations. So God's thinking about legacy, and we're thinking about need. So what we have to do in those times is be coachable, and what do we focus on? Are we going to focus on the husband? Are we going to focus on the wife? Are we going to focus on the business? Are we going to focus on our debt? I'm not going to think about debt because that's an obligation, so I got to start dreaming again, and I got to start thinking about possibilities. God, where are you at? Where do I go? When you're not hearing the voice of God, hang out with people who are. Oh, be coachable. My phone doesn't ring off the hook for coffee. I just got handed a six-figure check last week after the red on my board because I simply decided to do one thing God told me. The very thing I didn't want to do, he said, hire more people. I didn't want to do that. Him and I had a fit over it. He didn't have a fit, I did. Because all I saw was debt. Let's keep going. There's a point I'm kind of building up to. So then Boaz comes to her, he goes, after he directs her, watch this. He said at the beginning, this is in chapter 3, verse 10. He said, blessed are you of the Lord, my daughter, for you have shown more kindness at the end than at the beginning, and you did not go after young men, whether poor or rich. You had other stuff you could have pursued. God says, you didn't go after that. You had a need, but you didn't pursue that. And now, my daughter, do not fear. Watch this. I will do for you all that you request. For all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman. Watch this. Now it is true that I am a close relative. However, there's a relative that's closer than I. Man, I hope you get this. Boaz comes into her life. He has every ability to marry her, have a kid for her, have a legacy for her. He wants a wife and he wants a kid, but he shows restraint. He says, I'm going to honor God in this thing. He said, Ruth, there's one that's closer than me. He goes, this is not my job to provide for you. He said, I'll be your insurance plan, but I can't help you. All I can do is provide for you and make sure that your needs are met. But I can't do the exceedingly abundantly because that's not what I'm called to right now. See, there's this law that's set in place. And Boaz said, I got to look through the lineage to see whose responsibility you are. Oh, you're somebody else's responsibility right now. And people haven't done right by you. But you're someone else's responsibility. Watch this. So, chapter 4. Actually, let me go a little bit further in chapter 3. It says in verse 13, stay this night. Because he said, there's a relative that's closer than me. So he says, stay this night, and in the morning it shall be, if he will perform his duty of the close relative, watch this, let him do it. But if he doesn't want to perform the duty for you, then I'm going to go ahead and perform the duty. As for you, the Lord lives, lie down until morning. So she goes, she lays at his feet. There's no funny business going on. He said, you just lay there. He goes, my heart's for you, and I know your heart is for me, but I'm going to honor God in this whole thing. And if the man who is called to step up and do the right thing, if he steps up, then he's yours. But sleep right here because I'm going to show God that this is what I want. But man, I'm man enough to step back knowing that God's got something better for me. Ooh. But it goes down to chapter 4. Verse 1. Now Boaz went to the gate. The gate's a place of judgment. And he sat down there and behold, the close relative of whom Boaz had spoken by. So the close relative shows up. Oh snap. And watch this. Now do you feel like it's his opportunity? Do you feel like I was, when I was reading, I said, this dude could step up and take everything Boaz has. But it's his right. It's his responsibility. Well, what are you talking about? Well, there's a verse in Deuteronomy. And it's Deuteronomy, I want to say, I'm going to find it here because I need you to see it. Okay. It's in Deuteronomy, and I can't find it right now. In the book of Deuteronomy, it says when one person dies, the closest relative to you is supposed to provide for you. So why are they going back to Bethlehem? Because they're honoring God, and they know God will provide another relative for them because they're destitute. They've gone without. It's a place of famine. It's a place of hardship. And they know that if they go back to their own land and to their own family, somebody in the family is supposed to step up and provide for them. The Bible says in Luke 6:38, it says, given it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, running over. What does it say? God will cause men to pour into your bosom. So you mean there's an obligation? Yeah, do what's right. Give. Do everything God's called you to do. God says, I'm going to cause men. The men that have been appointed over your life, the Boazes that have been appointed over your life, God says, I'm going to cause them to sow unto you because you've kept covenant with me. But watch this. So he meets this dude at the gate. And this dude is the dude that is supposed to step up and do the right thing. Now, I don't know if you can relate to this because I looked at it when people owed me $94,000. And watch this. It says, Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, sold the piece of land which belonged to our brother Amalek. So there's a piece of land that actually belonged to Naomi that was sold after Amalek died. This is Naomi's husband, so he died. So there is a right of redemption in that family to get that land back. So what do they do? Well, Boaz spells it out because he's trying to take control and do the right thing and make sure everybody else, he's holding them accountable. He goes, I want this thing. It doesn't belong to me, but you will do the right thing. Now watch this. But if you redeem it, redeem it. So he's offering up to the guy, let's just call him Bob. He's offering up to Bob to do the right thing. So he says, Bob, if you're going to redeem the land, redeem it. But if you will not redeem it, then tell me that I may know, for there is one but you to redeem it, and I am next after you. And he said, I'm going to redeem it. So Bob says, I'm going to redeem it. I'm going to do the right thing. Okay, cool. So you want all the stuff. You want the treasure. He goes, yeah, I want all the treasure. He goes, okay, cool. Let me spell out the obligation that goes with this treasure. Now watch this. This is people dealing with people. And he said, I'll redeem it. Then Boaz says, one day you'll buy the field from the hand of Naomi. You must also buy it from Ruth, the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to perpetuate the name of the dead through his inheritance. There is a bloodline that needs to keep going. So the obligation for that bloodline is now on you, Bob. Sorry, Bob. Robert. And the close relative said, watch this. He started thinking. He says in verse 6, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I ruin my own inheritance. You're going to redeem my right of redemption for yourself. I can't redeem it. I was going to screw up what I got going on. You see, I got this piece right over here. I don't have a son yet, but I'm not married to the girl I was called to marry because God had a plan. And because this messes with my plan, it goes beyond my convenience. And I know God has called me to sow into your life, and I'm supposed to be your Boaz. I'm next in line to provide for you. I'm not going to do it. It messes up my thing. God will always give the person with one talent is going to be the person closest to you. He's going to give them the right to do the right thing for your life. And sometimes you're sitting there waiting. God's doing the same thing. They see the reward, but then they see that there is going to be a cost that is due, and it's going to go beyond their level of convenience to provide for you. But here's what God also has. He's got a Boaz standing in the wings for you. Let me tell you a story. My theology comes a lot from experience. Pastor knows his story. I got called to a flood call up in Edmonds. And I was in the basement and I saw these books, Christian author books. I'm not going to say her name, but I saw books everywhere. And she had a backflow in the sewer. So I'm looking at all the stuff, and I'm just like, wow, it's a mess. But then I look at one of the books, and for 10 minutes, I'm hitting my pencil on my notepad. I'm like, I know this name. I know this name. I know this name. I said, oh, that's... They were in Deliverance. They were like huge in Ballard. Husband and wife. Amy Sybil McPherson, Catherine Coleman. All those people went to their church when they came into town. Big name in ministry. And now the books are in a... They're in a basement. So I looked at one of the books, and the assistant came down. And so I said, the womb prayer. She says, what are you talking about? I said, the womb prayer. She's looking at me. She goes, what do you mean the womb prayer? I said, the womb prayer. I said, inner healing. She goes, how do you know that? She's your contract. I said, yeah. I said, I also pastor and do other things. And, you know, so she goes, well, let me take you upstairs to meet her. I didn't know she'd be dead in 6 months. I didn't know. So I'm sitting there. I said, God, I said, what am I doing here? Louder than anything I've heard, he said, you're her legacy. I said, she's got to have children being that old. He said, no children, no legacy. I said, oh. So she takes me upstairs, and the first thing I asked, I said, I want to know I'm hearing from God. I said, where's your children? She goes, I don't have any. I said, who's the ministry going to? It's going to such and such. She's the only one that really paid attention. And I'm like, standing in front of her, saying inside myself, tell me you're hearing from God right now. Because all that stuff in your ministry, your publishing company, all this is standing right in front of you. Pastor calls me. He goes, you know, when you walked right in front of her, she knew it was supposed to go to you. But the reason she hung on to the other lady, she said the other lady promised to remember her name. I said, what are you writing? She goes, I'm writing my biography, my memoir. I said, why? She goes, because I want them to remember my name when I leave. And I get done with the job. I'm driving up to her house. I just want her to lay hands on me. I heard God. Just pass your gift on to me. And I hit Bellevue. I was going to Edmonds. He goes, turn around, go home. I said, why? He said, she's not giving it to you. And watch this. Freely you receive, freely give. He goes, I never gave it to her to keep it. And it's not hers to keep. He goes, it belongs to you. I said, God, I said, what are you going to do? He goes, I'm going around you. He goes, I'm going around her. I said, you're going around her? He goes, yeah, I'm going around her. He goes, it's already on your life. Go home. I said, what? He goes, I already put the anointing. The same anointing that was on you is on them. He goes, it won't work for anybody else. So I go up there. I meet with the person that's taken over. We go through the board. Finally, the board hears from God, but it's too late because by the time the lady that took over got empowered, she fired everybody. I met with the lady. Pastor said, I agreed. They won't have 6 months left. I called Pastor Vince. He goes, this happened to me too. But God, after everything I've been through, he said, Greg, I always have your Boaz. He said, I'm always going to put people in your life that have one talent to do the right thing. God says, I want to increase them. I want to give them a chance to increase them. He said, because they won't worship me, because they have a bad perspective of me. He said, they may not do the right thing. He said, but maybe they will. And maybe they'll get to the two talents. Maybe the two is going to get to five. He said, but they won't do the right thing in your life. So he goes, I had to create an insurance plan for you. He goes, at any time I can call my Boaz who can open the doors to ministry, publishing, anything else that you need. He goes, but I'm going to call the people closest to you because those are the people with the one talent. I desire to increase them. And if they don't increase them, I'll call my Boaz. My Boaz is going to provide for you. But here's what he said. He goes, understand you're a Boaz for somebody else. He says, I'm raising up Boazes in this church. He goes, they're the insurance plan for somebody else. Well, Lord, how do I become a Boaz? You have to be able to walk in power. How do I walk in power? The exceedingly and abundantly only comes by way of having the power of the Word of God that's working in and through your life. He said, I had to do it. He goes, I've insured your success if you would just obey me. So God took the talent from him. And he gave it to the Boaz. And we read the end of the story. So it says that in chapter 4, verse 10, moreover, Ruth, the Moabitess, the widow of Mahlon, I've acquired as my wife to perpetuate the name of the dead through the inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and the position at the gate. Now watch this. chapter, verse 13. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And when he went into her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Then the woman said to Naomi, "Blessed the Lord who has not left you this day without a close relative, and may his name be famous in Israel." May his name be famous in Israel. "And may he be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is better than you, better to you than seven sons, has bore him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her bosom and became a nurse to him. Also the neighbor woman gave him a name, saying, "This is a son born to Naomi." And they called his name Obed. He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. Literally grafted Ruth into the bloodline. She had nothing. She said, "I'll follow you. People wronged you. God says, I have an insurance plan for you." What happened to Bob? It says that Obed was the father of Jesse, who was the father of David. So Obed was the great-grandfather of David for doing the right thing. But then it says his name's going to be great. Genesis 12 and 2. God promised to Abraham. He said, "If you follow me and obey me," he says, I'll give you the nations. He says, "I'm going to make your name great." That doesn't mean we go off on YouTube and try and make great of ourselves. God says, "If you do what I do, I'll make your name great." And we don't pursue the greatness of our name. We pursue the greatness of his name. And we do what we're called to do. God is trying to make Boazes in this church. But he's also going to start you off at one talent, that you would be faithful to do it, that you wouldn't think about urgency. You'd start thinking about possibility and start believing God and dreaming again, and know that you have an expiration date on your job. Yeah, I just mess with all of you. The jail cell is open, and you could stay in your place of security. Why am I doing this? Because I want you to start creating an atmosphere in your life that God at any day could speak to me and say, "Your time's up here. I got bigger and better things for you." Or you can stay in a place of obligation. It's really up to you. Go ahead and stand on your feet. There's two anointings that God released in the New Testament. The anointing for kings and priests. And you're called to walk in both. Oh yeah, I'll pray for the sick all day long. But make no mistake about it. God is not afraid to get you out of your mess, to make you the head and not the tail, above and never beneath, right? To be the lender and not the borrower. That's his plan for your life. And some of you kind of missed it. But I got to ask you, who's your coach? Who helps you make those decisions? You're not going to be any wiser than the company that you keep. You're not going to excel beyond the people that you surround yourself with. You want to be successful? Surround yourself with successful people. You want to be anointed? Surround yourself with anointed people. But here's the thing. There's many gifts and talents in this church. Kevin's knocking it out of the park. Highly gifted. Just because he may not be up here every Sunday, but I watch him. I see the anointing on his life. You better connect to some people right now that are knocking it out of the park. There is no excuse, and we cannot wait for the wheels to fall off the bus before we start moving. We can't wait until things have failed. God will position you in a time of famine, but he loves to position you in a time of strength. He will always tell you about the prosperity, and if you listen to his voice, listen to what pastor's saying, what I'm saying, we shift. And I tell everybody around me, if you watch me shift, you better pay attention. I'm doing it for a reason. Our lives are recession-proof. God desires to do it in you. Get out of your own way. It starts today. And I just want to create an atmosphere around your life to where you could start hearing the voice of God, to maybe you're not going to be encumbered by debt the rest of your life. To maybe God will give me a word. Maybe God will not only provide for me from the guy with one talent, but maybe, which he said in his word, he's got a Boaz watching over your life. He's just waiting to make sure somebody else does it. Here's my prayer. God, if they don't do it, I'll do it. If you won't do it, I'll do it. That's what Boaz says. If they won't do it, God, I'll do it. Give it to me, I'll take it. Pastor will do that any day of the week. If you won't do it, he'll do it. I'll snatch it out of your hands real quick. And I'll do something with it. I ain't playing. If you need a breakthrough and you're ready, willing, and able to say, God, I got a bullseye on my forehead. I want to step into the purpose you have for my life. It's not to be in debt. It's not to be in debt. It's not to have my mouth open, to have it owned. If that's you, just go ahead and come to the front. God wants to prosper you in the midst of any famine. And your prosperity in famine speaks louder than any prosperity in a position where the world has a strength. It speaks volume. Holy Spirit, I can't do it on my own. I want you to be willing to forgive yourself of your past so you can receive the big word. That's why the Bible says don't go before the throne with guilt and condemnation on your life. Guilt and condemnation will always prohibit the voice of God for your life. Because when you see yourself guilty, you respond in shame because you're unworthy. God, just give me a nickel. God gives based on his ability, not yours. He gives based on who he is. He's got your insurance plan. Why are you so scared? You only live once. Be willing to fail. If you're a member here at Seattle Christian Church, we're not going to let you fail. If I see you in failure, I'm going to reach out and kick you in the booty. But we're not going to let you fail. You got too many people here that are successful as well. We're not going to let you fail. Serve somebody. Serve a ministry. Serve the house. Get a coach. If you don't know Jesus, every eye closed. If you don't know the Jesus I know, and you want him operating in your life, and if you haven't declared him Lord of your life, lordship means rulership. Means, hey, I screwed everything else up. I want you in control from here on out. If that's what you want, with every eye closed, every head bowed, go ahead and just raise your hand. I see one hand, I see two hands, I see three hands. Amen. Four hands. Go ahead and put your hands down. Go ahead and repeat after me. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. I step down from the throne of my heart. And I ask you to be ruler over my life. To be the king over my life. Forgive me of all my sins. And I renounce every bit of wickedness that I held on to, knowing it's not your will for my life. In the name of Jesus and by the blood of Jesus, I bind every demonic stronghold, every demonic tie, and every entanglement. And I command you to leave my life now. Lord Jesus, I choose you and I choose the blessing. I choose to be obedient to your voice. Help me to hear you. Help me to move with you. You kind of freaked me out. That's okay. Go ahead and say it. You kind of freaked me out. You see a potential in me, then I don't always see myself. Help me to see in me what you see in me. Help me to see in me what you saw from the cross. The reason you died for me. The value that you saw in me. Your word says that I was worth it. Help me to see it. Help me to run the race. Help me to finish the race. In Jesus' name. Now go ahead and close your eyes. Lift your hands, just worship him. Holy Spirit, come upon this altar. And I declare every economy of every house, I command it to shift right now in the name of Jesus. I don't care what the news says. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what the NAR says. All that stuff. I don't care. They've been commissioned by you, Father, and you've commissioned them. And Lord, you said a long time ago, whatever I lay hands on, whatever I touch, you declared is blessed. And Father, I command every single person here blessed in the name of Jesus. Just stay in this place. Father, give them your very best. Commission them, Lord. Commission them for prosperity and for your abundance. In Jesus' name, just stay here. Father, the anointing of kings, the kingly anointing, the priestly anointing, now all the way through, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, all the way through, now in Jesus' name. There it is right there. Just take it. Just take it. Just take it. You guys are going to have to move. Boom. Go through it. Now in Jesus' name. There it is. Jesus' name. Take it. Take it. Take it. Jesus' name. There you go. This is a seed. Take it now in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Go. In Jesus' name. Just take it. Take it now. Take it now. Take it now. In Jesus' name. Take it now. There it is. There it is. All the way through. All the way through. In Jesus' name. All the way through. Take it. Now. Go. 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 Now in Jesus' name. Take it. In Jesus' name. All the way through. All the way through. Now in Jesus' name. Bam. Take it. In Jesus' name. Take it. Take it. There it goes. There it goes. Exceedingly abundantly. Now in Jesus' name. Just take it. There you go. All the way through. Bam. There it is. Now. Go. 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 Jesus' name. Bam. There it is. Take it. All the way through. All the way through. All the way through. Now. There it goes. There it goes. There it goes. There it is. Now. Now. Take it. Take it. Take it. Oh. There it goes. All the way through. Now. Take it. Take it. Take it now. In Jesus' name. Go ahead and lift your hands. Breathe in. Just breathe in. Bam. There it is. That's the Holy Spirit right there. Just take it. Just take it. Bam. There it is right there. Just take it. Bam. There it is. There it is. Close your eyes. Blow on our Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. King. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. King, Lord God. Every bit of heartache, everything. Father, just strength, Father. Continue to allow him to connect with you, Lord God. The strength of God, the ability of God, working in and through him, Father, anointing on his hands, Lord God. And Father, the word of God in his mouth and his heart, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. All the way through, Holy Spirit. You're already starting to work. You're already starting to work. Now finish it in Jesus' name. If you didn't pray, if you didn't get prayer and you want it, you better come down here. Kings and priests, Lord God. Kings and priests, Lord God. Kings and priests, now and take it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Kings and priests, there it goes. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name, take it. All the way through. Way through. Kings and priests, Lord God. I break fear off his life right now in the name of Jesus. I break it right now. Father, shift his economy now. Give him favor, north, south, east, and west. I command it now. Come forth now in Jesus' name. Boom, take it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a great big hand praise today. Glory to God. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Praise God. Well, that was outstanding, you guys. What a wonderful service that we've had today. I believe we've got an opportunity for some fellowship there over in the fellowship hall. Why don't you sit around? I always pray that the people will have an encounter with the Holy Spirit. They'll receive fresh revelation knowledge from the Word. But then the third part of your change is always the interaction with the people. So it's the fellowship with the people, the anointing on the people's lives that make the difference in people's lives over the long term. So I want to invite you to go across the hall there and just enter into some time. Take a good 15, 20 minutes and be late to your next appointment. Go on across there and we're going to have a meet. And there's some birthday cakes for all of the April birthdays. We want to bless all of the April birthdays. So please join us across the hall. God bless you guys. We'll see you here on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Praise God. Got some noon prayer. So God bless you. Have a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you.